Hey, good day, everybody. Welcome back to our Working Together series with our friends at NETIV down in the Houston Zoom room. We're just waiting on Rabbi Ingber to arrive, and we'll look forward. I enjoyed his message last week. But in the meantime, let's jump right in and say hello to Rod Bryant down in NETIV, and maybe he can tell us what's fresh and new down there with
Guys,
me, NETIV. Rod, you're live on our air.
Thank you so much. A lot of great stuff is happening in NETIV. It's our family here, obviously from really all over the country and the world. And it really is, we're very fortunate to have a community of people like this that come together and study, encourage each other, study the Torah, challenge each other with questions that need to be answered, and also challenge our rabbis. That's sort of part of the whole thing. We want to challenge our rabbis to provide us new information. So it's such a honor to be able to do that. And now we have Rabbi Ingber that comes in each Sunday, and he's going to pick up doing sort of a deep prod into the concept of the seven Noahide laws, the seven mitzvot, and to look at the nuances of them. Because when you get them, all these laws have most definite nuances that go all the way rooted back into many of the 613 commandments. So I'm really, really thrilled about this. Matter of fact, I had a Jewish guy from Israel send me a text and was asking me to explain the concept of the Sheva Mitzvot and how they're rooted in the other Torah, other parts of the Torah, as well as the oral Torah. And it was like a light went off. He's like, that makes sense. You know, you hear Sheva Mitzvot, just Sheva Mitzvot. And no one ever explains. Not only do they not explain what the Sheva Mitzvot are, they don't even go into the detail of how to live that out consciously. So we're excited. Rabbi Ingber, are you about ready to roll? Oh, just a second. So I'll keep on. I'll keep on yakking
anything
about it.
Anything new down there? You guys,
no, we're just
more classes?
Actually, we just, no, same classes. I do know that I have another person wanting to do another series, but I think I'm going to do that on another day. So I'm still trying to work on the details on that, but it'll be more of a polemic discussion about Christianity.
Once your schedule gets full, it's full. I get it.
Yeah, it's full. Yeah, it really is. It's not that I really get into a lot of polemic studies, but I know someone who does, and he has a gentle way of sort of bringing out these differences between Christianity and then what Judaism and Torah actually says. So we're working on the details. I asked him to send me an outline or a syllabus so I can kind of know the plan at the time. But it really is an exciting time. We're well over 21,000 subscribers, so we're very happy about that. And life is treating us well. Life is. How about you, Dan?
Well, I mean, there's always room for improvement. You know, I've been doing a lot more work outside in the past year, and you know, I handed out a Brit Shalom book. I'm doing security. I have a post and a patrol. So when I post up, I find I meet a lot of local people, and I've been in conversations with lots of people. And yesterday, I had a 74-year-old gentleman stop, and I gave him a copy of a Brit Shalom book, and we've been having conversations. And so he's asking all kinds of conversations. He actually took the book home in the morning about 8:30, and then came back by 2 o'clock in the afternoon before my shift ended with a bunch of questions. So, you know, you get out there, and, you know, everyday life is important. So how you live it can make or break the difference in someone else's life. It's not just about all the personal study time, but I find when I do get my post, I can read a bit. So I've been reading a lot of Rabbi Nachman of Breslov lately, and lots of books. So new ideas and room to grow for sure. And I enjoy this class. This class has been getting pretty heated up the last several weeks. I enjoy where Rabbi Ingber's taking it. And so I see he's with us now. If want to turn it over to him, and Rabbi Ingber, so good to be with you, sir. And we're going to give the class over to you, and look forward to hearing what you have to share. Oh, you're muted. No, your microphone's muted. Oh, yeah, on the Zoom app. The Zoom app, you've got your microphone muted. No, you just turned your camera. Okay, your camera's good. You need to turn on the microphone. I think you can send him a prompt on. Let me see if I can send you a prompt here.
Now, you hear me now?
Yeah, we can hear you now, Rabbi. You're live on the air, and I'll blink this out for you.
Okay, good. So good to see everybody. Let's talk about a lot of things. Yeah, last week I saw an introduction. I wanted you to understand the seven commandments, the seven mitzvot. Yes, there are larger numbers, larger details, but seven is a significant number, and it has a structure, and it's an inclusive concept. So we talked last week about the idea of understanding one God and no other power, and how that's central to a lot of the bad stuff coming out of the world today. And people, how, you know, when you say I'm a good person, but you don't believe in God, so what does that mean? Are you really a good person? We'll get into that more deeply. I want to do one of the other ones we talked about, and I explained a little bit the idea of there's different kinds of relationships you could have. You could have three kinds of relationships between humans and fellow humans, right? Between you and God, and you and yourself. Those are the three types of relationships you have, because a person, you know, and they're all interconnected in the sense that there's no such thing as being a nice person to other people and not understanding it comes from God. And likewise, you can't act properly towards God and not right to the people he created, and same thing with yourself. If you're not going to act properly to yourself, and that's where people misunderstand the concept. If you're not going to act properly to yourself, then you are going to be negative to your relationship to God and to other people. Now, when I say that, people say, what do you mean? I'm good to myself. Isn't that giving myself whatever I want? And the answer is no. To be good to yourself, you need to understand who you really are and what you really want. Because if you, by nature, really want bad things, that's a problem. And the truth is that people that are like that are not tapping into the godly way that they were created. They're not tuned into the verse that says that God made man b'tzelem Elohim, in the divine image. There is an aspect of whatever you want to call it, because it's different technical names, but the aspect of soul, the aspect of a part that is in an image of the divine. Obviously, God has no image, but in the different ways that we talk about, either it means he can understand, we could choose between good and evil, all the various explanations, what it means to be that type of entity. So when a person feels that they are doing things that are they have different wants, different desires. So very often they're hooking up to the external part of themselves. And if they hooked into the deeper part of themselves, they might realize that that's not what I really want. So for example, if I'm addicted to something, I might want it physically, right? I might want this drugs. I'm addicted to it. I might want the food I'm addicted to. But the deeper part of myself knows this is not good for me. Okay? So I want to talk about the commandments, the seven Noahide commandments about illicit relations. Okay? And I want to take it from a very different angle than we normally hear about, and we can get into the specifics of what is forbidden and not forbidden, but I want to take it from the positive side to understand what we are striving for. And this verse in the Torah is one of the sources for the forbidden nature of some of the illicit relations. So the verse says in the book of Bereishis, the book of Genesis, it says, Al ken yazov ish aviv esimo. So when after God created Chava, Eve, so Adam realized this was his other half. He had looked at the creation, he had seen everything, and he knew nothing was his match. He meditated on the nature of the lion, the nature of the bear, the nature of all things in the created world, and he knew that he was not his equal. It was not his other half was not in the picture. Then God brings Chava to him, Eve, and he says, this time it is bone for my bone, flesh for my flesh. This will be called the woman. She comes from me. She's a part of me. Okay. Now the verse says, Alken, therefore, Yazav Isha Vivasimo, a person will leave his, a man will leave his father and mother, the Davak Beishto, he will cling to his wife, the Hayu Lebosar Echad, and there'll be one flesh. This is actually the source of some of the different forbidden aspects of forbidden relationships for the Noahide. So, for example, it says a man should davak, should be unified with his wife, not someone else's wife. Okay. Adultery. Davak means two things that will actually come together, that can unify. And they will be one flesh, something that could make one flesh. So, for example, and I'm going to leave this for the discussion now, what can make one flesh? Well, you can't produce a child from a relationship between a human being and an animal. As a matter of fact, you can't have the what's called the dveikut, the clinging, the uniting, the melding into oneness that the male-female dimension creates. And I want you to understand this, because before telling you all the things that we can't do, you have to understand where we're going. What are we trying to create? We're trying to create a union of male-female that becomes one. This is a different concept what people understand in the world. Now, let me explain this to you so you understand. And this is really, you know, people are all obviously up in arms today because they have their things that they decided that logically this is okay, it's acceptable, it's the right thing. And before getting into saying these people, that people, I'm sure everyone on this station, you know, in this group could understand it, but people in the world who have major issues of homosexuality and all different abbreviations, you know, just let me explain what we're going for and to understand it. If I take, let's say, a piece of wood. And this is a graphic model, but it is a literal model. I take a piece of wood and I carve out this piece of wood into two. Okay. That when I put them together, the piece of wood becomes one piece of wood again, like a jigsaw puzzle. The only way you could actually have oneness is when the piece was one. And the carving you made was exactly meant to reconnect. The male-female dimension, and this is, if you look at it biologically, you'll see it's obvious. There is, I mean, I don't want to be too graphic, but we all have can understand this. There is, in the spiritual realms, what happens is there's something called a mashbiz and mount kabel. The giver, the receiver, in whatever dynamics we have that. If you look at the biology of male, female, you understand how, just on the biological level, it's built in such a way that they fit together. Okay. The biological level is not separate from the spiritual, emotional, and psychological level, it's a reflection of it. And therefore, what happens right now is that, and this is why a person that is meant to be married to the right person, their other half, is a perfect fit. Because what happens is that that's the way it was carved out. The deeper meaning of the souls being one and then carving out that there's a place where they come together is the idea of becoming one. That's what the verse says. The verse is v'davak be'ishto, that the male and the female have this thing of dveikus. It dveikus is I it is not a good word in English. I said cleave, but it's not the right word. It's a complete unification that if the piece does not fit into the system, if it's not carved out from the original one piece, it won't fit exactly right. Certainly, if I have two, so to speak, pieces in a jigsaw puzzle that are both protruding or both indented, then they won't go together. The qualification here of the relationship is to become one. And I explained this to you once before. Let me just bring it again. We once asked the question, what is better? Birds that flock together, birds of the feather flock together, or opposites attract? Which one is more correct? The two sayings are completely opposite, right? Birds of a feather flock together. It means that the more you are like somebody, the more you will have a connection with them. And an opposite attract means the people that are opposite, well, they like each other more. So which one of these things is true? How do we understand what's going on in the world? So the first level of the answer is similar things are what like each other. And if you look at that, you'll see. I have someone that is like me. I feel automatically a connection, right? You go meet somebody, you say, "Where are you from?" Why do you say such a statement? The guy says, "I'm from Texas." And you say, "Yeah, really? Do you know Jim?" I know Jim. I mean, how many guys named Jim are there in Texas? Why did you ask me the question? Because you are building a connection with me. We have something in common, right? We're both from Texas. A guy named Jim. Right? So the people look for commonality. So the sages ask, so how do you have a male female? If they like commonality, how do male female unite? And the verse says to us, Zohar ben Akeva, God created everything the male female to unite. So how is it possible then if people naturally like people that are more like them, how does a male female unite in that way? So the sages tell us like this, explain the following. I gave this example before, but when I am hot, I just ran, I want a cold drink. And I'm cold, I want a hot drink. Why do I want the opposite there? Because I'm not looking for something like me that I could relate to. I'm looking for someone that is part of me. I am looking to be completed. That's a completely different idea. When I'm hot, I need something cold. I'm cold, I need something hot. It's not because I'm myself and I'm looking for someone like me to converse with. No, the male female becomes one literally. There's a famous story of Rabbi Aryeh Levine. One time he went to the doctor because his wife had a problem with her leg. And he went to the doctor and he said, "Doctor, we have a big problem." That's what's the problem? That's our leg is hurting us. Doctor said, "What? Our leg is hurting us." And the doctor like cleans his ear like three times. Like, who's the patient here? But that's the answer. The answer was that we are the patient. He felt his wife's leg like his own leg. That's really, and that is actually, in Jewish law, the law is that a man must love his wife like himself and honor her more than himself. If he has one pillow, he gives it to the wife. So again, there's obligations male towards male towards female, female towards male. So this is where the world has gone nuts because they don't understand that men and women are different. They need different things. And everyone's pointing, you need to do this, and you need to do that. No, when I teach male and female how to interact, I first do it separate. This is what you need to do. This is what you need to do. This is a relationship between you and God also. You have to act properly towards your wife. Wife has to act properly towards your husband. And so everyone has to understand, what do I need to do? Now, generally speaking, when you do the right thing, there's a reciprocality in the relationship, reciprocity. So that would usually happen. But what happens is that every person has to understand we're not you know, this when once the world has come out with this new idea that, you know, which they developed since the 50s, or and for all years they've been messed up in this whole male female dynamic, but women and men are the same. No, they're different. No, they're the same. No, there's not men and women anymore. So the whole whole feminist movement changed, right? Back in the 50s, it was like started out in the first feminist wave was that, you know, women and men are the same. If you give a girl a truck and you give a boy a Barbie doll, so they'll want to play that. That was the first idea. That didn't work, and then it changed. It became no. Carol Gilligan did studies in the 90s that showed men and women were different, and everyone was, wow, how could that be? And now, well, they've tried a new system. There's no men, there's no women. But these things are not true. Men have certain qualities, certain ways to see the world. Women have different ways. And what happens is a couple becomes one unit. They blend and they're supposed to meld to become really one. The differences are not, you know, just random differences. The differences are completing the whole. And that really is to understand what's behind the whole problem of the various illicit relations. So it says, V'dovak b'ish, is that a meld with his wife, they have to be of male-female where they can actually meld into one, not where there are two things that don't meld into one. If they have to create a child because they become boser echad, they become one flesh, they have to be able to create a child together. So a human being can't go and have relations with an animal because they cannot become one, they cannot become united. That is the root of all of the details. All of the details of what is forbidden in illicit relations for the Noahides, this is also for Jews, even though there are various differences in the practical halacha. But you have to understand the deeper idea here. Instead of looking at what can't you do, look at it what you're supposed to do. You are supposed to build a relationship with a male-female uniting and understanding that we are different, we have different responsibilities, how we have to act towards each other. But my other half is my half. In Jewish law, we don't consider a person who's not married, we don't consider him whole in many ways. He's not called a full person for many aspects of Jewish law. To become whole, this is needed. Now, again, I know sometimes it's difficult. I know sometimes people have not found the person they could marry, and really the advice for that is if what I'm saying to you now, I think is the impractical advice to go to the next stage of development, because when a person realizes that's how I'm going to be whole, I just got to do it. I my mind is towards it. I pray, I ask God, and then the doors are going to open up because you realize how central this really is to your existence. And that's why I think I mentioned to you once, I saw a book on marriage and relationships. And it was a pretty good book. This guy named Harville Hendricks, a pretty good book. Not bad. He had some good ideas. But from the title of the book, I knew he was wrong from the title. The title of the book already, he lost me. The title was called Getting the Love You Want. I knew he was wrong already. If he would have called the book Giving the Love You Should, then I would have said it's a good book. Because what Harville Hendricks was trying to do is he had this whole idea about evolution. So, and some parts were actually pretty good in the sense that he missed the point that there's different levels you relate to your spouse, to your partner. And what happens is that since you have to fill each other, you're going to find that your spouse will have challenges. And everyone's gotten married and believes that, now we're in love and now everything's going to be so perfect. They're not in reality, because pretty soon after you get together, you realize, wait a minute, there's a lot of issues that we each have. Oh, was this a mistake? The answer is no, not necessarily, probably not. And this is a very important thing. The answer is that very often, in normal cases, your spouse's problems and challenges are what you need to work on to give to become whole. You hear what I'm saying? If you really view this as a union, and like I said in the story, Rabbi Ari Levine, and he said to the doctor, our leg hurts. If you really view it as one unit, you realize that the person you end up with may have challenges, and it's not just, oh, they have that problem, and I want to get rid of that. That very often is what you have to actually do in your own development to give to that person where they have a shortcoming and vice versa. So what happens is that the root of the forbidden aspect in the seven Noahide laws of illicit relations with all of their parameters, we could talk about those parameters in a minute, but the root of it is that every human being should strive to connect to somebody, a male-female bond that they will become one with, meld into one person, and that is the sense of wholeness. And that's and specifically it comes with the male-female dimension being so different that I need to give. It's like, you know, it's like a guy is like, you know, always say an example. I used to live in Atlanta. So, you know, the guy loves his wife, wants to give his wife a present. He buys her season tickets to the Falcons. Well, you know, that's very nice if your wife happens to like football. But if she doesn't and you're giving yourself a present, that's not the point. The point is that the way they relate, other person relates something which is so different. It's like, you know, with all the counseling, you know, this is well known, but I you see it a million times where a person, couple comes in and they start with the same story. The wife says the husband comes home and she's telling him that frustrated her. And the husband starts to say, I know what you should do. Do this, do that. And the wife says, you're not listening to me. He says, I did listen to it. I told you what to do. I heard it and I solved it. And this is well-known stereotypical things, but it's really true. And I know, like myself, I know, like for years in my marriage, it was like there were points where I would have to like just bite my tongue. I heard the idea, what my wife said. I had a really good male solution. Like I knew what I was going to say, you know, but I knew she wasn't finished expressing herself. And until I got good at it, I had to just tell myself, shut up, dummy. Don't say anything. Listen, she's saying more. Don't go into your own mode. Well, what was that about? Because I function differently. When I'm sitting with my guy friends, maybe we'll help solve it that way. But that's not my world. I had to be in the other person's world. The level of giving that's required is a stretch of the person because it's expanding themselves to include this whole other dimension that is part of them. That's what the verse says to us. The verse says that a man will leave his husband, his father or mother, and he will davak beishto, he will unite with his wife, and they will become one flesh. That's the goal. And therefore, let's look at it in the positive, understanding that the seven Noahide laws is encouraging that potential to really unite with someone and to feel that I've expanded out of my own, instead of giving to someone like me, I have given to fulfill myself, complete myself with my other half that completes and makes me whole. All right, that's my thought. I'm going to open up to ideas, comments, and questions.